Hey everyone, episode 24やってきました。さあ、過去皆さん僕はですねたくさんのことをしてきたんですけど、その中でね本当にやってよかったなと思えるのがこの Airbnb でホストしていたことですね。福岡に住んでいた時にやったんですけど、1年くらいかな、1年以上したかもしれないですね、もしかしたら。まあその中でたくさんのねこの旅人に出会って、でその中で本当に今でも連絡を取り合うような仲の友達もたくさんできました。で今日のゲストブロディもねその一人でカナダからやってきた旅人でしたね。彼が福岡にやってきた理由というのが、その福岡のカフェをねいろいろとリサーチしたいということで、スケートボードと一緒に現れたこのブロディ、今もですねこのノーマットブロディ、ノーマットバリスタとして活躍するこのブロディにねたくさん話を聞いて、そして5、6年ぶりのね、キャッチアップを僕も楽しみました。ということでね、皆さんもこの会話をぜひ楽しんでリラックスしてね、そしてもうぜひね、このコーヒーを飲みながら、この会話、キャッチアップを楽しんでください。OK! So, how have you been, Brody?
Hey,
it's been a while, man.
Yeah, it's been 3 years now, I think.
No, I think more than that, like, cause.
Oh, yeah,
that was 2015 or 16, yeah.
It's 2016.
A long time ago, yeah. Yeah, 2016,
so,
yeah.
4 years now, yeah.
Yeah, 4 years, yeah. Well, like, I've been doing this podcast things for a long time, kind of. It's on and off, like, I had, like, you know, the 1 year blank or something.
Okay.
But I always wanted to like bring you as a guest on my show because I still remember the moment that you stayed at my place as an Airbnb guest, and then like you had like skateboard with you, and you made this like beautiful AeroPress coffee like in the morning. That was like super good. So I was like, oh, this dude is so cool. Like one day I have to bring this guy to this my podcast show. And well, then like a week ago, somehow just I remembered you, and I was like, oh, I have to just DM him. And then I wasn't too sure because you have so many followers and then you seem super busy. But like you kindly like, you know, message me back like right after I sent the message. I was like, oh, yes. And now it's happening.
Hey, man. Well, I look at all my messages. You know, I love one of the things that I value the most is connection. And so like, you know, when we got to connect in Fukuoka, like, anytime that I have a chance to share, you know, my coffee or my lifestyle or stories, you know, I'm very happy to do so. So I'm very happy that you contacted me for sure.
Yeah, cool, man. Yeah. Yeah. Why don't you just tell us a little bit about yourself? Because I know you, but the listeners, they don't know about you.
So, where should I start? What should I focus on? There's a lot going on.
Yeah, I know. Just tell us your like a superhero story, like since the when this guy was born or something.
Well, here's a funny story to start, based on my last trip in Japan, and it was probably the most extreme thing that happened to me in Japan. I was it was at the end of our trip. I already met you in Fukuoka, yeah. and I took a train back to Hiroshima, and I stayed there for a few days. You know, went to the museum, went to a few coffee shops. It was very beautiful, and and then I took a bus to the airport thinking that I was going to sleep in the airport and take a very early morning flight. But I didn't realize that the Hiroshima airport was actually closed that night. And so I was there at 9 p.m. or something. I was on the computer. I was editing photos. And then the security guard came up to me. I was actually video FaceTiming my friend in Tokyo. And she was, I asked her, hey, so what's this guy saying to me? And she's like, talk to him on my phone. And he said, yeah, we're closing. And I'm like, what do you mean you're closing? You're an airport. He's like, no, we're closing. And he took me downstairs to another girl. And she was like, yeah, we're closed. It's you know, the airport doesn't stay open all night. And at this point, I was far away from the city. You know, I didn't want to spend money. Even the hotels were sold out, the ones nearby. And I didn't want to spend so much money taking a taxi and everything back to town. So I slept in the stairway outside of the Hiroshima airport overnight. It was like April, so like it was raining. It wasn't that warm. Obviously, it wasn't snowing, so I survived. Yeah. But I had to sleep overnight in the stairway, like very cold. You know, I didn't have a blanket or anything. So that was like one of the most extreme nomad part of my Japan journey.
It is, yeah. I don't even know some like airports are not 24/7. Yeah.
Most of them.
The airport can be closed.
Hiroshima.
But anyway, yeah. Yeah, Hiroshima, yeah, yeah. Now I know, yeah.
But yeah, that's you know, so that's me. I go by the Nomad Brody on Instagram. But during that trip was the first of my journey on this blog that I had just created called The Nomad Barista. And so, yeah. You know, as you know, but I'm going to tell, you know, the listeners, I work in coffee. I'm a coffee professional, but not in the traditional sense that you might imagine. You know, I've worked behind the coffee bar as a barista, you know, making latte art, making pour overs. And but what I specialize in as a coffee professional is more on the communication side and photography and, you know, telling the story behind the coffee. Yeah. And so this is what I've always been very passionate about since I started to get into specialty coffee. And that was the main reason why I wanted to travel to Japan back in 2016 was to just hear the stories of very passionate, you know, Japanese right. business owners, baristas, coffee roasters, all the way from Tokyo to Fukuoka and everywhere in between. And so, you know, that's kind of the approach that I've always taken is like, okay, yeah. Where can I meet some people who are really diving into their passion with coffee and really trying to make a difference in their community, mm-hmm. whether they're a coffee grower, you know, on some farm producing coffee, or they are, you know, a cafe owner or a barista with bringing people in from the local neighborhood and providing right. a beautiful space for them. You know, for me, it's like this connection between all different parts of the supply chain in coffee is so beautiful. And I want to, you know, I believe coffee is a force for good. And as long as we know how to communicate it, you know, we can help this industry to expand and do even better things. So that's where I'm coming from.
It's cool, man. Yeah. What I like about this podcast now is maybe the listeners can see us, but like both of us just like, you know, like shipping coffee.
Yeah. With our little cups.
Yeah. With a little cup. Yeah. This is that I got from like a Tokyo, like a coffee festival.
Oh, nice. Can,
yeah. Yeah.
I've heard of it.
Yeah. It was pretty cool.
So
there's so many like cafes like came to this like festival. Even like some cafes are from overseas. Like I think some of them are from Hong Kong, and I saw one from San Francisco.
Yeah,
but yeah, it was pretty dope. Yeah,
that's funny because my cup that I'm sipping on is actually I picked it up in Brooklyn, New York, at a vintage store, like secondhand store. But if you look on the bottom, it says "Made in Japan." It's like some sort of made in Japan ceramic. So
I can see that. It's kind of minimalistic style. Of yeah, cup, yeah.
I love it.
Yeah. Are you sipping tea? No, right? Because I could see the string or something.
It is tea. I'm a big
Come
imposter.
On, you're a coffee guy. Yeah.
I'm a big imposter. Yeah, but for you, it's like 8:30 a.m. Here, it's already
oh, that's right. yeah,
7
yeah,
p.m.
Yeah.
So I have to sip yeah. some tea.
Yeah. How many cups of coffee do you drink, by the way? Yeah.
Yeah, so people ask me that a lot. I think it totally yeah. depends on the day. Some days if I'm doing like a coffee tour and meeting a bunch of different people at yeah. the roastery, or if I'm tasting new coffees, I could have up to, you know, probably like, or if I'm working in the cafe and I have to taste the espressos or I have to taste the coffees that I'm serving,
yeah.
you know, maybe like five or six or seven. So
Damn,
yeah. other days, you know, I might, you know, a chill day, maybe I'll only have one or two. It just right, depends. Yeah. I like to listen to like what my body is telling me. But if you have too many, yeah, like there's different strategies for dealing with over caffeination, like drinking more water, eating more food. But yeah, I can take a lot of coffee for sure.
Wow. You have a high tolerance probably, the caffeine yeah. tolerance. Yeah. I did that 2 months, almost 2 months. No, like I was like 44 days caffeine free challenge. Yeah. And that was horrible. You shouldn't do that.
Did you feel any changes afterwards?
Oh, yeah. I mean, like, I just felt like shit. Like, I couldn't feel any motivations of the first or second week.
Okay.
And I just felt like energized. But yeah. Those things okay. are like the something I could expect. But then I was expecting some benefits, but the benefit never came to me. And I was like, oh, why am I doing this? Like,
You're expecting like a Buddhist enlightenment.
Or just like, you know, just your, I'm like my, you know, like base energy level or something.
Yeah.
Might increase. That's what I read on the website. So I was like, oh, maybe I should give a shot, but it wasn't worth it.
Some people talk to me about quitting caffeine, you know, and I'm never going to tell, like, I'm a coffee professional, but I'm never going to convince someone who doesn't drink coffee that they should drink coffee. Like, that's not my job. But my, you know, my job is to help people who I, you know, are drinking maybe bad coffee or not even bad coffee, but they don't really know where it comes from. They don't really know what the farmers are being paid for it, or they don't really know, you know, too much information about it. And I know that they could actually have a, such a tasty, beautiful cup of coffee just by finding the right one for them.
Yeah.
And so, you know, it, that's more the way that I like to help people direct, you know, when they're drinking coffee. But sometimes people tell me like, oh yeah, I'm going to quit coffee. And yeah, I guess for me, I never thought about it. For me, I don't feel like it does anything wrong. But I think some people, maybe it does. Like maybe they recognize they're not getting good enough sleep, or that it's affecting like their stomach, you know, making their stomach feel bad or something. So, but yes, it's, I don't think it's the same like alcohol, where it's like, it's nice to take a break from alcohol because, you know, it's hard on your liver.
It is.
But the coffee, I think it has a lot of health benefits.
Yeah. There are a lot of them. Yeah. Then like other thing, I think why coffee is super good. It's not just like as a, you know, like a beverage. It's also like, I like when I'm making coffee, like kind of like a literal things. Yeah. This behavior of just making coffee gives me like kind of happiness and then this peaceful moment. Yeah. So that's like, oh, I missed this. Yeah. And then I had to go back.
That is a huge part of what I, you know, like about coffee as well. That's actually part of what got me into, you know, coffee in general. Was before I never drank coffee before I discovered like this subculture of specialty coffee, like back in 2014 was like the first time that I really started drinking coffee. And, it was for me really about the way that it brings people together, you know, the kind of nice group of people. It's something you can share, but also the way that you can like prepare a coffee by hand. You know, it's not just about ripping up, open a package and putting in a cup. Like this is like something where you put love in, you put care into it, and it's like cooking a meal for someone. Right. And, that's what really, I'm glad that you brought that up, because for me, it really is like more of a morning meditation. Like I don't want it to be so instant. I want it to have like more meaning.
Yeah. Cause I, once again, like I still remember the moment you actually, you know, just grind your beans, like the morning that you were about to leave from my place, you just, you know, took out your coffee beans and then you ground it. Before I met you, like I was like, oh, like, why would you, like, why don't you just buy the powder thing? But I think you told some stories or something. So just this idea of just grinding the coffee beans and just, you know, making just one simple cup of coffee could bring a joy is maybe thanks to you. So now I'm just grinding my coffee beans and something.
Well, that's a great story that I love to hear when like something that, you know, some sort of coffee impact I can make on someone, you know, because, yeah, it's cool. How do you relate your coffee now to like your appreciation for fitness and what you do kind of, you know, for activity and how does the coffee influence that?
Yeah. Well, as I told you, like, I just like the moment when I wake up early. Well, I'm kind of like a morning person, so I wake up early and then just so quiet. Like the city is also quiet, and then just, you know, just grinding these coffee beans and then making a cup of coffee gives me peace. So this is one thing. And also, as obviously the coffee can give me energy, kind of. I can feel that. Like, especially like when I was like off the caffeine, like I was just less, not motivated, but I would say like less energized. It sounds kind of, I'm addicted, but like, that's what how I relate to my fitness and things. Yeah. And also, like, I like to just, you know, just go into just cool cafe with, like, friends and then just, like, having conversation with baristas, listening, like, hearing the stories, and something like that, Hey, 今回のゲストプロディはですね、トロント出身の、ですね、ノーマットバリスタという名前で活動している、なんて言ったらいいのかな。まあ、自分も言ってましたけど、いろんなことしてると言ってましたね。このフォトグラファーもやってるし、まあ、基本的には最近はこのコーヒーコンサルタントという、仕事をしてると言ってました。彼とはね、この僕が福岡で Airbnb をしているときに、ゲストとして、やってきて、その時にね、この本当にもうスケートボードと、あとはこのコーヒーのね、このエアロプレスの機械とかと一緒にやってきたんですけど、彼はですね、この福岡にこのコーヒーカフェ、リサーチのために来たみたいな感じで言ってたのを覚えてます。で、その時からね、すごく、話もね、すごく面白くて、まあ、その時もすでにノーマットブロディだったので、まあ、いろんなところ転々としていて、で、その、チェックアウトする日の朝に、コーヒーをね、作ってくれたんですよね。で、その時に僕も全くそのコーヒー、まあ、好きだったんですけど、自分で豆を挽いたりっていうことの意味がわからないくらい、コーヒーに対してはそこまでパッションを持ってなかったんですけど、その時にね、このブロディが、このコーヒー、自分の手で一からね、その豆を敷いてくれて、で、それでエアロプレスで入れてくれたのを今でも覚えてますね。で、そのコーヒーがめちゃめちゃ美味しくて、で、いつかね、またこのキャッチアップしたいなとその時思っていたんですけど、今回ね、やっとこのブロディをね、ゲストとして迎えることができたので、このエピソードになってますね。で、この二人でも話してたんですけど、そうですね、まあ、ブロディもすごくですね、今、インスタグラムとかを皆さん、このショートの、ショーノートの方にもシェアしてるんですけど、すごいね、大活躍しているので、忙しいかなと思ったんですけど、メッセージ送ったらね、すぐにね、返事くれたので、こういうふうに今回実現しました。で、そうですね。まあ、今回のね、ポッドキャスト、このビデオ、ズームですね、しながら話したんですけど、二人ともね、このコーヒーの、マグカップをね、持ってコーヒー飲みながらやってた。と思いきや、僕がね、この持ってたのはこの東京コーヒーフェスティバルっていう、すごくね、いろんなカフェとかが集まってくる。日本中から、世界中、まあ、世界からもね、日本だけじゃなくて、ゲスト、カフェということで、毎年違うカフェがやってくるみたいなんですけど、2017年かな ?2018 年かどっちか忘れちゃったんですけど、に行った時にもらっ、買ったかな?このチケットと一緒についてくるので、そのテイスティングカップですね。それで飲んでました。でね、ブロディもコーヒー飲んでるかと思いきや、ティーだったということで、ちょっと面白かったんですけど、まあ、時差があるのでね、このブロディも、カナダのトロントに住んでるということで、そうですね。まあ、大体時差があったので、まあ、向こうは夜で、こっちは朝という時に収録しました。で、そうですね。まあ、ブロディもね、このコーヒーコンサルタントとして、まあ、自分のカフェをね、一緒に共同経営したりとか、まあ、あとはそのカフェをしたい人、まあ、この後話出てくるんですけど、そういった人に対してのアドバイスなどしていく上で、やっぱりこのコーヒーとかをね、たくさん飲むと思うんですけど、大体まあ、5、6杯ぐらい飲むというふうに言ってましたね。で、まあ、本当にもう自分の体が OK な限り飲む。まあ、自分の体がもういっぱいいっぱいって言ったら、まあ、やめるくらい。Listen to my body っていうふうに言ってましたね。Oh yeah. そしてこの僕がね、このカフェイン抜きのね、カフェインフリー44日間やったんですよ、皆さん。これね、すごく面白い経験だったんですけど、まあ、なぜこのカフェインを抜こうと思ったかというと、まあ、カフェインをね、やめるとすごくこのエナジーのレベル、子供の時とか朝起きたらすごくエナジーいっぱいいっぱいだったじゃないですか。まあそんな風になったりとか。まあすごくですね、いろんな健康効果があるよという本、まあまたはブログなどを読んで、OK、よしやってみようということで、僕やってました。44日間。でもですね、なかなかこの、みんなが言うような、いい健康効果というのが出て、まあ見る気配がなかったので、このまま続けてもいいなとは思ったんですけど、まあなぜかというと人によってはやはり僕みたいにコーヒーをね、この5年間ぐらい毎朝飲むという習慣がある人は、このすべてのカフェインを体から抜き出すというのに時間がそれかかりますよね。なんで、まあ人によってはね、この44日間なんて言わずにも何ヶ月、数ヶ月間もかかる効果が見えるまでっていうのも知ってたんですけど、やっぱりね、このコーヒーから得られるこの喜びですね。やはりこの毎朝コーヒーを入れるところから、すごくね、僕も、まあ儀式って言っちゃおかしいんですけど、感じるところがあったので、やはりね、このコーヒーがあるライフスタイルの方が、僕は幸せかなと思い、戻りましたね。で、まあ、それに対してね、ブロディともお話ししてたんですけど、まあ、このコーヒースペシャリストのブロディも、まあ、そういった、もちろんこのカフェインで、睡眠がなくなっちゃうとか、睡眠に影響が出ちゃうとか、まあ、そういったちょっと、 肌に不害が出てしまうというレポートもしているというふうに言ってましたが、まあそのコーヒースペシャリストでできることは、まあコーヒー、例えばそのインスタントのコーヒーじゃなくて、本当にオーガニックなとても美味しいコーヒーっていうのがあるんだよっていうのをみんなに知ってもらったりとか、そういったことをですね、話してましたね。んで、まあなぜこのコーヒーが好きかというところでも話も出てたんですけど、まあただそのドリンクとして美味しいから好きっていうわけじゃなくて、まあその実際にその自分の手でその美味しいコーヒーを作ってあげれる。まあ料理とかもそうですよね。料理も誰かのために自分の手でこの美味しい料理を作ってあげれる。それと同じようにコーヒーも自分の手で作ることができる。そういったことをシェアできる。そういったのがね、このコーヒーの魅力だねっていう話を今のところしてましたね。How about you? Like how did this all like coffee thing started? What like cooked you?
Yeah.
Is there like any special story?
Yeah, there's a few things that happened, but both, you know, were very impactful and special, yeah, for me to get into it. So, you know, I was still in university. I was actually at the time, like I told you, I used to live in China back in 2013 in Yunnan.
Yeah.
So Yunnan province is like the coffee growing region of China, close to Myanmar, close to Vietnam. So I started to sort of experience coffee more firsthand. Of course, I grew up around coffee in Canada. You know, my parents always drank it, in the morning, but I was never interested, you know, but until I went to China and I started to realize, wow, this coffee's like grown in the same province, you know, local people, local indigenous people are, you know, picking it and it's kind of like part of this whole community. So I started drinking it sometimes there and going to some cool coffee shops. And then when I came back to Canada, I just randomly met some other people, some other Canadian friends who were brewing this kind of thing at home. But what interests me about that too was not only, you know, the fact that it can bring people together and it was this, you know, handcrafted, you know, work of art and also science. And they were using scales and they were using these temperature kettles and hand, you know, grinding. And, but also what I loved was that they're using like a local roaster that has, you know, put a lot of really cool design into the bag and the packaging. But then each coffee comes from a different country and each one was designed in a different way and each one tastes a different way. And so for me, you know, cause I love travel and I've lived in a few different countries now and I love experiencing these different cultures. I thought this is one small way where I can connect with another country without actually going there, without having to be anywhere else. I can consciously think, wow, I'm drinking coffee that was picked and grown in Ethiopia. And so for me, it was actually Ethiopian coffee, which for a lot of people who have like this revelation about coffee and they, you know, when they get into it, it's actually an Ethiopian coffee because that's the birthplace of coffee. It's the very, very first place where it was ever grown, over 400, 500 years ago. And so it has very unique, distinct flavors, you know, it's more soft. It's a little bit more like, you know, flower type flavor or like herbal flavors. And, you know, some of them taste like green tea, some of them jasmine. And so it was very unique. I thought this is so different from anything I ever taste. It's not a tea. It's not a hot chocolate. Yeah. It's not, you know, not my typical, flavor for coffee. And I thought at that moment, I thought, I'm going to get into this. I want to know more. And so it was at, you know, during that time that I was, you know, starting to make my own coffee at home and starting to go to different coffee shops, meet other baristas. And later that year, I actually took a trip across Europe for, you know, I had to go to Denmark for school for like a class, just like a quick class. And so during that time, I investigated more like the European coffee culture and how they have this longer history of espresso. And you know, in Canada, espresso is kind of more new than it is obviously in Europe, like Italy and France and Spain. So, that's when I really got into that whole side of coffee where it's like more espresso. And, you know, then I went up to the Netherlands and I went to Denmark and Belgium. And it was really just cool to see that European side of, cafe culture, which is very strong, very long.
Yeah. Like Europe is somewhere like I never been to. So I'm quite excited to go there. I'm planning to visit there like this autumn, hopefully.
It's a beautiful place. I will be there. I'm living in Canada now, but I'm moving back to Spain, you know, once the borders open up again. So
Whoa, why is that for job or you just liked it?
I just like it.
Well, tell me about it. Like, what's like aspect of Spain you like? Siesta?
Yeah, for sure. So I live in Siesta. I love the fiesta. I love the siesta. Partying and napping is a big part of the culture there. But at the same time, my first experience with Barcelona specifically, one of the best cities in Spain on the Mediterranean. I went the very first time back in 2012. This was my first big trip away from home, away from Canada by myself. And I was there for another class. It was an architecture class because Barcelona is very well known for its architecture, for its, its culture and, food. So we were studying, Gaudi, which is, an old architect from Barcelona, but also, some other urban planning, type, design styles that they made very well in Barcelona. And so it wasn't that I knew about Barcelona. It was actually from skateboarding culture. So as you mentioned earlier in the call, like I brought my skateboard to Japan. Like I used to skateboard a lot, but back in like the years 2000, 2003 to 2008 or so, Barcelona became this like very, very popular hotspot for skateboarders to go and make videos and make photos because it's basically a playground. Like there's so many beautiful architecture there, and the police, they generally didn't kick you out of any spot, so you could go anywhere. So I knew about it just watching videos from home. And then when I went there, I fell in love with the city. I fell in love with the culture. I felt, I really wanted to learn Spanish at the time. And so I went that one time in 2012. And then it wasn't until 2016, right after we met, actually, I went back to Canada. I got a visa and I moved to Barcelona. So
Wow, cool. So you actually lived there. Nice.
I lived in Barcelona for a year during that time. And then pretty much every year I go back.
What?
And so this time I realized, and you were asking me another time about, my nomad lifestyle and if I'm still going traveling and living in different places. And so, what happened was, this year, I started this year actually in Thailand. I was in Thailand.
So random,
I did the
I like
beautiful,
it.
like, New Year's Eve was incredible because there was they do like this lantern tradition. I'm sure they
Oh,
have like lanterns all over Asia, but in Thailand they do like they set off thousands of lanterns into the sky,
That's
into
the like a Lapunzel thing, right? The Disney movie Lapunzel. I
the...
don't know if you
Maybe.
will. I think Well, anyway,
Maybe. They do it twice, one for like the Yeah, they do it twice in the year, but one of the big ones is the New Year's Eve. And so, anyways, I started in Thailand, loved it, went to India for some work, which was like recording video and photos on coffee farms. So that was, I was doing a project with actually a Korean coffee roaster. And then from there, I went back to Thailand and I was traveling around and I was meeting up with friends and things, but I realized, you know what? This is just part of my habit. This is just part of my everyday life, like living in different places. Sometimes I'll live back home in Canada, but then I'll leave again because I get tired of like the same thing all the time. And so I thought, you know what? Where I need to find a home somewhere because I need to start like, it's very hard to build a business when it's very hard to start a business when you're not really sure where you're gonna go next, or like you're always in a new place, you're always around new people. And so I was thinking to myself, hey, look, I lived in Barcelona a few times. I love it there. I have a community there. I love being in Europe. And so I decided I'm going to move back. So that was earlier this year in February. I decided I'm going to move back to Barcelona and see if I can, stay there again. But then, of course, the coronavirus got a lot more serious. And fortunately, I did make it back to Canada in time. But then I had to stay here. So for the last few months, I've been staying here in Canada, like, living at my parents' house, which is the opposite of nomad, lifestyle. But it's been great. And I've really appreciated the time, like spending time with them and with, back with my old friends and things like that. But yeah, the next step for me is to set up a home in Barcelona again, just because I like the city. I just that's my city and I like the people there and I love the sea, being by the sea and the mountains and the coffee culture, the wine culture. And so, yeah, that's my next step.
That's cool, man. Yeah, so nice. Yeah. Yeah, I kind of agree with you. Like, traveling is like super cool. Being nomad is super cool. But I think for me, I don't know, maybe some people have different opinions. It's great because I know that I have a home. Like, I know that I can go back to like where I'm from anytime and always. Yeah. So, yeah, that's cool. Barcelona
That was the
sounds
thing
awesome.
I always missed was like I was always doing this nomad journey, but it was always for a few months at a time. And anytime that I left, I would leave my room behind. I would, I never owned a house or anything, right? So I would just have a room somewhere for a few months, maybe in Toronto, maybe in Spain, and then I would just leave it because I don't want to pay rent and have all these responsibilities. And then, but then it means that I don't have a place to come back to. Yeah, so I want to change that
さあ、この部分は、どのようにしてこのブロディがコーヒーにハマっていたのか、っていう話題から始まりましたね。ブロディ、この大学生の時に、まあ、中国のユアン地方っていうね、コーヒー、産業がとても盛んなとこに住んでいたことがあって、まあ、そこでですね、まあ、そういったコーヒーが実際にそのローカルの人が作って、ローカルの人が、コーヒー豆を摘んで、で、そこでいろんなカフェがですね、まあ、そういった豆を使ってコーヒーを作ってる、そういったのに、ですね、体験する機会がたくさんあったようですね。で、そこで、わお、コーヒーって、ただ、もともとね、その、ブロディもカナダ育ちの時に親とかがね、飲んでた、まあ、缶から出てくるコーヒーをな、だけじゃなくて、まあ、こんな裏の世界があったのかとか、そういったのを目の当たりにしたところからコーヒーの興味、コーヒーへの興味、みたいなのが、始まったようですね。で、そこからまあ、中国から帰ってきて、まあ、カナダで、まあ、たまたま会った友達が同じようにそのコーヒーを、まあ、一からね、この、ちゃんと豆を挽いてとか、そういったのを見てるのを目にして、またね、そこでいろんな話で盛り上がり、そしてこのコーヒー、カフェですね。本当にいろんな、国から取ってきた豆の地方のことを書かれていた、コーヒー豆のバッグだったり、そういったのを見て、このコーヒー、もともとブロディも旅行が好きだったので、いろんなところに実際に行かなくても、そのコーヒー豆を飲むことで、その国のことを知れたり、まあその国のことと繋がったような感じになれることがとてもね、魅力的だと感じて、コーヒーの世界にどっぷり入っていったというふうに言ってましたね。まあこのエチオピマとかも、豆よくあるんですけど、まあエチオピア行ったことないけど、まあそのエチオピアの豆のことをね、学べば学ぶほど、そのエチオピマのことをね、もう行ったことのあるかのような感じになれるのがとてもいいというふうに言ってましたね。で、そっから、そうですね、この、2015年か2016年にこの、日本とか回った後に、まあ、カナダに帰って、その後にね、このヨーロッパに行く機会があったというふうに言ってましたね。で、このヨーロッパに行けば、ヨーロッパに行くと、まあそうですね、本当にこのエスプレッソカルチャーですよね、このイタリアとか、まあまたこのスペインのエスプレッソカルチャーにどんどんとね、まあ、ヨーロッパに行ったら、いろんなヨーロッパのコーヒーカルチャーを学ぶことができたと。いうふうに言ってましたね。で、そこで、まあ、このヨーロッパのスペインの話になってきましたね。まあ、このノーマットブロディということで紹介をしてたんですけど、実はね、このブロディ、このヨーロッパのバルセロナにね、とても、恋をして、まあ、その街にね、住んだこともあるというふうに言ってたんですけど、まあ、もともとこのままコロナとかが起きなければ、このバルセロナにね、ノーマットではなくて、そこにしっかりとその自分のベースというか、家を持ってね、住むようなプランを立てていたようですね。やはりこのノーマットライフというのはとてもね、魅力的で思えるんですけど、やっぱりこのビジネスとかのことを考えると、まあ、一つの場所、ベースがあった方がやりやすい。まあ、あとはですね、このいつにノーマットしていて、まあ、帰れるような家、まあ、部屋とか、そういったものがあるっていう生活もね、ちょっと恋しくなったので、このバルセロナにね、今から移ろうとしているということを言ってましたね。Cool, man. So, like, business-wise, like, have you been doing the same one thing this whole time, or you've been like picking up like a temporary stuff when you need it?
Yeah, that's a really good question. It's for business for me, it's not been the same thing the whole time, but I have always worked for myself. So it's more like, and I have picked up little barista jobs making coffee, but that's mostly just because I love doing it. My main income has always come from photography, and video projects and also coffee consulting projects. And so this is, photography is more well known profession, yeah. obviously, like, you know, it's you don't have to explain too much to someone, like, okay, I'm a photographer, I take pictures. Maybe you have different styles of taking pictures. For me, you know, I specialize more in travel photography or stock photography or product photography, telling stories with the products. I don't do too much studio. But when I tell people I'm a coffee consultant or I work on coffee projects, that involves a little bit more explaining.
Yeah, I was going to ask you that. What specifically would you do?
Yeah, so I'll explain because it has changed over the years too. So, you know, because it is such a different type of thing, or it's maybe like a new type of position that never existed before, I've had to really do a lot of learning myself what that looks like. But it started for me when I was living in Barcelona, actually. And I already had my blog and I was already taking a lot of pictures and I was working as a barista. And then I started meeting people in the city who needed to start cafes, but they didn't really know too much about coffee. And so I told them, well, I have a lot of experience talking with different people, you know, traveling, taking pictures. I'm going to help you to set up your coffee program. And then through that, you know, I started to do other projects that were related to coffee, but also photography and video and communications. Like, how are you telling the story about coffee? And so it was a bit of half and half. I was consulting, you know, new cafes to open, but I was also working to craft, you know, to write journal articles or take photos for different companies. So that's how it started. And I moved back to Toronto and I was consulting a few shops there and starting to create a YouTube channel, which I've been growing since then.
Oh, you got a YouTube channel?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So I have a YouTube channel. It's called, it's just by my name, Brody Vissers, but it's the channel name is like The Nomad Barista. So the same as my blog. And so, yeah, through that process, you know, over the last few years, you know, I've been able to work with different people to do either coffee pop-ups, you know, I view coffee as a great way as well to act as a tool to bring people in, you know, it's like, it gets people interested. Let's say you're doing a pop-up where you want to show off some art. Well, serve some coffee on the side and it's going to attract people. Yeah. They come for coffee. They look at your art or, you know, maybe real estate. Maybe there's more, you know, commercial type applications where, you know, maybe a real estate agent wants to show off like some condos. Okay. Make some coffee, bring some people in, you know, I like these types of collaborations because coffee can be used as such a great tool to start to connect people. So I started making like events like this. And then over the years, you know, up until now, what I do now is basically work with brands one-on-one, work with clients one-on-one to really examine their coffee communication strategy. So what are they doing to be different as a brand? What are they doing to differentiate themselves, but also how are they looking ahead into the future about like, where do they want to grow? So it's a little bit of business model, you know, strategies, but it's more focused on the communication side of things. How are you attracting new customers? How are you deciding who your audience should be? Because realistically, you know, especially for smaller companies, it's not about being the biggest and the best, you know, and having the best coffee or having like all the coolest coffee shop. It's about finding the right people that resonate and connect with your brand, because that's really going to allow you to grow and gain momentum. So I help people through that process, just by, you know, having, now we can work remote. So I do these kind of Zoom meetings with people and we work through these different challenges and we come up with different projects and I help them to brainstorm. And so that's been really rewarding. And then the other side of it is creating more coffee related content. So video content for different brands, you know, whether it's for YouTube or photography or for their own channels. So that's been really rewarding too.
はい、ということで、ここでは結構ね、みんなも気になってたと思う、このノーマ・ブロディの収入源ですね、について聞いていました。で、この、ブロディがね、初めて言ってたのが、I always work for myself というふうに言ってましたね。まあ、いつでも、まあ、自分に働くというふうに言ってましたね。まあ、自分が自分のボスというか、そんな感じですよね。で、まあ、一番の収入という、元々の収入はですね、まあ、このビデオグラフィー、ビデオを作ったり、またフォトグラフィーですね。写真を撮ったり、というふうに言ってましたね。まあ、写真もそのクライアントに頼まれた写真を撮ったり、まあ、あとはそのストックフリーの、コピーライトフリーの写真を撮ってウェブサイトにシェアしたりとか、そういったものというふうに言ってました。 まあ、そこともう一つね、とても気になったのが、このコーヒーコンサルタントという意味で言ってましたね。で、このコーヒーコンサルタントって僕もね、今まで、で、ほとんどの人は聞いたことないような職種だと思うんですけど、一体何なんだということを聞いてみたら、本当にですね、名前の通り、このカフェとか、まあ、またはですね、まあ、ブランドですよね、コーヒーブランドとか、コーヒーに関係するビジネスだったら何でも、まあ、そういったところに、まあ、本当に名前の通りコンサルタントをする。まあ、一緒にプロジェクトを考えたり、まあ、あとはこのメディアですよね。このウェブメディア、一緒に作ってあげたり、コンテンツ、ビデオコンテンツ、写真のコンテンツを一緒に作ってあげたり、そういったことをワンオンワン、もう一対一でやってるというふうに言ってましたね。もともと、このコーヒーコンサルタントというのも、このバルセロナでね、たまたまと言っちゃうのかもしれないですけど、バルセロナで初めて、始めたというふうに言ってましたね。まあ、そこで、まあ、カフェを始めたいっていう人に出会って、Hey, 僕はこのコーヒーのこととかもいっぱい知ってるし、まあ、いろんな人とも、知り合いとかいるし、ということで、このコーヒーコンサルタントとして、みたいな感じで、まあ、そこから始まって、で、まあ、最初はこのコーヒーコンサルタティングだけだったんですけど、まあ、どんどんそこからその、写真の仕事に、どんどん繋がっていったりとか、大きくなっていったというふうに言ってましたね。で、今は本当に、もうこのカナダとかで帰ってきても、まあ、ウェブベースで、そういったコーヒーコンサルタントの仕事を、行ったり、まあ、あとは本当に、このポップアップのイベントですよね。ここで、ブロディが言ってたことで僕も、わあ、確かになと思ったのが、このコーヒーっていうのが、この、会話ですよね。この皆さんのコミュニケーションを始めるツール、まあ、会話を始めるツールになると、いいツールだと考えてるというふうに言ってましたね。まあ、例えば、その、まあ、車のね、ショーケースとかそういったのイベントでもいいんですけど、まあ、そこにコーヒーのポップアップとかがあれば、まあ、そのちょっとコーヒー飲んでかないとか、そういった風にみんなが来やすくなる、人を引きつけるような、人が集まる場所のように、そのコーヒーのポップアップが、カフェのポップアップがあればなる。まあ、そういった感じで、いろんなイベントとコラボレーションしたりするのが好きだという風に言ってましたね。まあ、これもこのコーヒーコンサルタントの仕事の一つで、どんどんとやってると言ってましたね。とてもクリエイティブですよね。はい、このコーヒーコンサルタントとかね、まあそういったことを今仕事としてやってるこのブローディなんですけど、一体こういったことを大学とかで学んだのかなと思って、大学で何を勉強したなと聞いたら、勉強したのが面白いですね、これも。Urban Planning というふうに言ってましたね。まあシティプランニングとも言ってたんですけど、まあこれはどういったことかというと、建築に近いんですけど、まあその建築はその建物についてかと思うんですけど、ではなくてこのアーバンプランニングっていうのはその建物と建物の間のスペースとか、それの使い方の勉強。まあ、どのようにこの街とかを設計していけば、人々が心地よくね、暮らせるのか。まあそれは健康的にもだし、まあそのメンタル的にも、どういったいい暮らしができるのか。そういった、ことを勉強するのがこのアーバンプランニングというふうに言ってましたね。で、まあ、こういったアーバンプランニングを勉強していく中で、まあ、このコミュニティですよね。まあ、たくさんの人が一緒に暮らしていくこのコミュニティを作っていくという点で、このコーヒーがですね、すごくいろんな人を引きつける力がある、ということに気づき始めた、と言ってましたね。なので結局は、今コーヒーコンサルタントとして働いてるんですけど、こういったアーバンプランニングが直接関係してはなかったかのように見えるんですけど、まあ、このコーヒーというツールでですね、このコミュニティを作っていくという点では、このアーバンプランニングもね、同じじゃないかというふうに振り返って今言ってましたね。そしてこのビデオとね、この写真のフォトグラフィーとかどうやって勉強したのって聞いたみたいなんですけど、この写真もですね、この初めて中国に、住むことになったときに、まあ今まで行ったことないアジアとかを、やっぱり、自分が見たものをもう見たものそのまま、まあ友達とか家族、まあいろんな人に伝えたい。ということで、よし、だったら、いいカメラを買って、そしてその写真のことを勉強して、それで写真に収めていこうということから始まったみたいですね。で、もちろん、まあ、自分で写真を撮ったりっていうことから慣れていったこともあるんですけど、まあ、YouTube ビデオを見たり、まあ、あとはね、面白いなと思ったのがこの Instagram ですね。まあ、その頃、Instagram がちょうどなんか流行り出した頃かな。で、まあ、この人フォトグラファーでいいなと思ったらそのアングルとかを真似したりとか、まあ、あとは実際にこの Instagram の中でこのフォトグラファーなりたい人というか、フォトグラファーのコミュニティっていうのもどんどんできていたみたいで、 まあ、実際にそのフォトグラファー、フォローしてる人とメッセージとかやり取りして会って、まあ、お互い写真を撮り合ったりとか、まあ、いろんな話を聞いたりとか、実際に会ってそのコミュニティの人と、フォトグラファーの人と話をして、まあ、そういったことからこのフォトグラファーのスキルをね、どんどんと高めていったというふうに言ってましたね。Yeah. And the other part that I was super curious is maybe about Japan, because you're super liking Japan, right? Although you stayed only 2 weeks, but you were earlier talking me how much you love Japan. So let's talk about Japanese, the coffee scene or coffee culture.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I feel like I'm not alone in liking Japan. I think a lot of people, when you tell them about Japan, they even if they've never been there, they're like, "Oh, Japan, I love it. It's so cool." It's
But
true.
I have to tell this, like, I hosted like many guests like through Airbnb, but like everyone, you know, I ask you usually, like, hey, like, what brought you here? And everybody's like, oh, food or just anime or mostly food, ramen. But you're the only guy like, oh, like I'm here to just research, you know, the cafes in Japan. I was like, wow, this dude, it's so cool. But anyway, yeah.
Well, I think that really, it reveals what is unique about Japan in a general sense. And the general sense is not that the coffee is unique. It's not that the food is, even though the food is unique, the unique part of it, and I think what attracts a lot of people is the passion of the Japanese people to do things very, very well and to make them look very, very good and to make them taste very, very good. And so, you can see it in the art, you can see it in the architecture, you can see it in the train system, you can see it in the ramen, the sushi. There's that documentary. It was at like Jiro's Dream.
Oh yeah, sushi guy, right?
The sushi guy, and like, you just see the passion, the sake. Like I love sake because it's such a unique drink. And so, yeah, when I came here, that was the real purpose, was I wanted to see, because the specialty, well, the coffee culture here in Japan is also, it's very unique. I mean, it's similar to other places, but the Japanese people do it to a different level, And so, that's what brought me here, because I knew that the architecture of the cafes was going to be very, very beautiful. I knew that they have a long history of making coffee from back in the day when, they used to go to Brazil to work on the coffee farms, and then the Brazilian people came over to Japan a little bit too. And so there was a lot of, early trade of coffee into Japan. And so just seeing that kiseten culture, with the nail drip, the cloth filter drip, and just, yes, studying. I like to study the rich culture of coffee and just see how, you mentioned earlier you went to this Tokyo Coffee Festival, and like people came probably from all over Japan, but all over Asia to celebrate, what are people doing in coffee here in Japan. So yeah, that's one thing that I really recognized on that trip in Japan when I was traveling, on the Shinkansen and visiting different shops. And I would tell people, yeah, I'm here just like doing a coffee tour across the country. And they were so excited. Like for me, it gave me such a nice feeling to know that these people were so happy that I was there visiting and exploring, coffee. And so, just told me, it just showed me how passionate the people are here, and that's something that really made a big impression on me.
Cool, man. Yeah, like I read your blog, man. It's well written. Like I like the one you had the interview with oh, what's the name of the cafe? The Moment Coffee.
Yeah.
That's
Thanks,
pretty cool,
man.
yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't
And
even know the fact I and Red Coffee, right?
yeah, Rec, he's he was the one of the barista champions of Japan at one point. Yeah, a few times.
He was also saying about like the this very specific, how do I say, like Japanese way of just persisting on the quality on everything,
Yeah.
right? Like
Yeah.
food, ramen,
Exactly.
but it's so interesting, like being a Japanese and living in Japan, like those things, like I just don't just see it, but like hearing from you, like from different perspectives, like I was like, wow, yeah, that's kind of true, yeah, and it's kind of cool, yeah.
It was interesting how many people that I spoke to when I was in Japan who told me like that they, you know, they were introduced to coffee, or maybe they were never introduced to coffee, but they went down to Australia, to Melbourne, to learn English or to study. And then in Melbourne, because Melbourne is a very, very big, you know, key point for coffee. It's a big city for coffee. And they learned about coffee, or they got into it, you know, as a barista or, you know, working at a roastery. And then they came back to Japan and started a coffee company based on that experience. And I thought that was such a cool, it's a trend for sure, but it's such a cool trend, you know, that impacted a lot of people.
Right. Yeah. How about like Australia and New Zealand? Have you been there?
I've never been.
For real? Yeah.
It's too far.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's just too far from everywhere. But like New Zealand coffee is really good too. Like you don't like flat white and those stuff.
They do a really great job. New Zealand and Australia, they invented so many great parts of the coffee industry that I work in and the industry that I know. Flat whites, you know, it's very popular now everywhere in the world. I don't really drink it because I really don't drink coffee with milk. I just, you know, if I'm drinking coffee, I just drink the black coffee. But I think it's a great drink, you know, to be served in cafes, and because, yeah, it pairs so well, you know, with the espresso. I think what makes it unique is the fact that it doesn't have to be super foamy. I think a lot of mistakes that people make when they make like a milk espresso drink is that it's too foamy, it's too airy. And flat white is a little bit more like, you know, mixing with the milk and the coffee. And also it's less milk. You know, what the big culture, especially in the United States, but also Canada too, is like having a huge, like, you know, 16 ounce, 20 ounce coffee that's like, you know, as big as your head with mostly milk. And it's like, I don't think that's healthy.
Yeah. Yeah, that's kind of sad, but that's true.
But flat white's a good size.
Yeah, like there are some like New Zealand cafes in Tokyo. It's called, I'm so bad at names, I just can't remember. But they serve like nice flat white in Tokyo, so I sometimes swing by there
to get
the coffee. Yeah, yeah. So if you are forced to pick one cafe in Japan, like what's your favorite cafe?
That's a really good question.
Question. Yeah,
yeah, but and why, you know, maybe, you know, there was a. Yeah, there was definitely some that stood out to me. I would say one of the most influential cafes in Japan that I really like their aesthetic. I like their business model. I'm going to be completely honest. I don't think that their coffee is like that great anymore. Maybe in the beginning it used to be, but now it's started to get a little bit too dark for my flavor. But that is Arabica. Arabica.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
In Kyoto, right? Yeah, they started in Kyoto, near the bamboo forest. And then, like, he had a few different locations in Kyoto. And then he started to branch out, but not only just in Japan, but all over Asia, you know, started to go to Malaysia, started to go to China, Korea, probably some other places. And then the Middle East. And then now in Europe, like, there's one in Berlin. So I really like how they were able to kind of like, streamline, because it's so beautiful. If you look up Arabica, you know, the cafe, it's very beautiful what they do. And you know, I've been to a few locations now, so yeah, that's definitely one of the most impressionable cafes that I've been to. But if I were to share like my favorite one, I would probably say like in Tokyo, there was kind of one that stood out to me called Onibus. It was like owned by the coffee roaster Onibus, but they had a few different cafes. One of them was called About Life, and it's a small little cafe. You can barely even go inside, but it just has a window where you can stand outside and order coffee. And there's a small little indoor space. And then they have another one called Ratio C. And so Ratio C is like, it's a bike cafe, so that you can go inside and it has all this bike gear, but it's very beautiful, like the cafe section. So I liked how they were able to kind of bring those two industries together, and those, you know, turn coffee, again, like I was saying earlier, into like this collaboration aspect where you bring people in for the coffee, but then they can check out the bike, you know, because I love cycling. I've done a lot of cycling in the past, and you know, I did a bike trip across Spain at one point, and I want to do more of these kind of bike trips. And I think cycling and coffee really goes together very well. So you know, that kind of place really stood out to me for that reason. And But it pretty much every coffee shop that I went into in Japan, like, made a different impression on me. It's very clean, very, you know, minimalist, but
yeah,
a lot of character, you know, a lot of reason. Everything that you pick up, you know, you pick this up and it's like there's a reason that it was there. And so, yeah, I mean, it's great. Even this cup actually is Kinto Japan.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
I have another little cup here that I'm showing. So yeah, the design makes a big impact on me for sure.
yeah. I'm going to put those cafes on my show notes so that the audience can look it up later.
Yeah, for sure.
Pretty cool, man. Yeah. ここではね、日本のコーヒーカルチャーについていろいろと話してるんですけど、まあ、なぜこのブロディがこの日本のコーヒーはすごいか。まあ、というかブロディも言ってるんですけど、まあ、ブロディだけではなくても本当に多くの人が日本ファンの人は多いと言ってました。まあ、その中でやっぱり共通することっていうのが、何事に対してもそのクオリティ、質ですよね。質を本当に求めるっていうところが、あの魅力だと感じるというふうに言ってましたね。まあ、それはワインでもウイスキーでもそうですよね。まあ、あとはその寿司とかも本当に美味しい極限の寿司を目指したり、ラーメンとかもすごくこの一杯のラーメンにすっごいいろんなエナジーというか、そういったものを注いで、すごくいい質を目指すじゃないですか。まあ、それと同じでコーヒーも、この一杯のコーヒーにかけるこの質へのこだわりというか、そういったとこが魅力を感じるというふうに言ってましたね。まあ、これっていうのは、もともとこの喫茶店カルチャーから日本も始まったので、この喫茶店の文化だったり、まあ、あとは、ちょっとちょろっと出てきたんですけど、あの、寿司職人のこの二郎さんですよね。二郎さんのムービーなど、ドキュメントかな？ドキュメンタリーを見て、まあ、そういった、いろんなですね、この日本人の質に対する固執というか、こだわりですね。そういったのはすごい定評があるというふうにね、言ってましたね。で、そんな中で、まあ、2週間ぐらい日本に、いたんですけど、まあ、いろいろとこのカフェをね、たくさんいろんなとこ回って、ちょっとね、話も出てきたのは、この、ぜひこのブロディのブログも皆さん読んでほしいんですけど、福岡のね、まあ、僕も福岡出身なんですけど、このレックコーヒーとか、まあ、あとはモーメントコーヒーというところの、オーナーとインタビューをして、そこでもね、そういったこのクオリティに対する個室みたいなところがうまく表現されてましたね、このブログの中に。で、やっぱり日本人としてね、なかなか普通に暮らしてるとそういった観点って気づかないじゃないですか。やはりこういうふうにね、海外の人から、まあ、またはその外に住んでる人からそう言われると、おお、確かに日本ってそういうとこ素敵だよな、というふうに僕もね、思い知らされましたね。で、まあ、このお気に入りの、じゃあ、いろんな見た中で、このノーマ・ブロディのお気に入りのカフェはどこですか？まあ、一番好きだなと思ったのは、という質問に対して、まあ、答えが2通りあったんですけども、1つは、まあ、この影響力、この世界に対する影響力として、一番すごいと思ったのが、このアラビカコーヒーですよね。まあ、京都発祥のこのアラビカさんなんですけど、僕もね、この嵐山の横にあるアラビカコーヒー、めちゃくちゃかっこいい、スタイリッシュなところなんですけど、行ったことがあります。で、今、なんとびっくり、僕も、ウェブサイトでね、後ほど調べてみたら、すごい世界にね、52ぐらいロケーション抱えているようで、今見たらね、カンボジアとかにもあるし、まあ、ヨーロッパのベルリンとか、まあ、あとはこのイギリスとか、いろんなところにモロッコとかにも、フランスとかにも、そして中国とかたくさんいろんなところにこの店舗抱えているみたいですね。まあ、ちょっとね、ブロディは、このアラビカ最初よりちょっと味が落ちたかなとかいうふうに言ってたんですけど、まあ、でもそういった意味でもね、この、影響力という意味で、このアラビカコーヒーが一番かなというふうに言ってましたね。今後どんどんとね、皆さんもぜひウェブサイト見てもわかるように、いろんなところに店舗をこれからも増やしていくみたいですね。そして、まあ、それ以外でっていうところでは、この東京のカフェをね、いくつか挙げてましたが、この、そうですね、この、オニバスコーヒーっていうところがやっている二つのカフェですね。まあ、オニバスコーヒーがきっと、ロスタリですよね。豆とかを販売している。まあ、ところがやってる、一つが、アバウトライフっていう、ちっちゃなカフェみたいですね。もう本当にこのコーヒーを多分テイクアウトして 行くようなところ。そしてもう一つがこのレイシオ&シーっていうところですね。こちらはバイクショップと混合になっているところのようで、やっぱりね、この自転車とこのコーヒー、すごくカルチャーが似ているというか、よくね、いいペアリングというか、いいマッチングですよね。僕も本当にそう思います。以前もね、バイク乗ってたので。なのでね、両方とも僕は行ったことないんですけど、ぜひね、行ってみたいと思うので、ぜひ、ショーノートの方皆さん、リンク貼ってますので、チェックしてみてください。Alright, yeah. Maybe another thing I wanted to ask you is just going back to like being nomad aspect.
Yeah.
Because I'm one of them who want to, you know, have a nomad lifestyle sometime in my life. What the, like, one piece of advice would you give to those people?
Yeah, that's great too. I would, I think the number one piece of advice for being, you know, if you are interested in experiencing the nomad lifestyle, even if it's just for a little while, just to get that off your chest or like, you know, out of your system, is just let down some of your priorities, let down some of your comforts. You know, the only way that you're really going to truly embrace and experience the benefits of being having a nomad lifestyle is by learning to accept things that happen around you, you know, right. And like, there's so many nights. I mean, I was experiencing it in a way where, I just didn't want to spend too much money either. So I wasn't staying in hotels. Like, to me, going around the world and staying in hotels is not really nomad lifestyle. Like, that's just traveling.
Yeah.
But for me, there was so many nights where I was like, I don't know where I'm going to sleep tonight, you know, or I don't know who I'm going to run into. Or like, there's some days where you're lonely. You're just like, I didn't meet anyone that was very interesting today. Or, you know, some nights you don't feel like going out and exploring because you just did that for the last 30 days. But it's about just, I think the biggest quality that having nomad lifestyle can give you is the ability to really reflect on yourself, because you don't have the comfort of just being able to distract yourself with, you know, the routine, or like, you might not have friends around you. So it pushes you out of your comfort zone to talk to strangers. It pushes out of your comfort zone to stay in a new place. Maybe it's in a jungle in kind of like this bamboo hut, or maybe, you know, it's on this hostel on the beach, or maybe you take it to the extreme where you're sleeping outside the Hiroshima airport like me. I'm not recommending that, but that is one aspect. So I think, yeah, just take it as a way to jump out of your comfort zone, and then you will really experience the benefits.
Cool. Nice, man. Yeah. Yeah, definitely people watch out for Hiroshima airport.
Yeah. Yeah, don't go there. Don't go there at night thinking that you're going to sleep on the benches.
Yeah.
But the amount of times that I slept in the Hong Kong airport overnight, like, you know, I thought it was normal.
Yeah, I mean, that's what most people do at the airport, right? Just sleeping or just watching movies.
Yeah.
I like the South Korea Incheon airport. Have you been there? Like, Incheon airport is, I think it's super comfortable. Like, they have so many facilities to just relax or just, you know, stay overnight.
I have been there, but I never spent overnight.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Anyway, Yeah, this is, I think, I reckon this, like, podcast, you know, there are many audience who's, like, listening to me, like, every episode. So I consider this as a community as well. So maybe you can do, like, some shout out to just, you know, where we can find you online, or what you do, what we can do for your business. Like,
yeah, for sure.
Beans. Yeah. Well, you said you own your cafe still?
Right. So this is something I didn't mention on this podcast, but last year with a business partner, I did start a cafe in Toronto with him, but it was more like supporting him to start his cafe vision. And then I continued on to do my work. So my company, my agency is called San Coffee Room. So Ichi Ni San, like San Coffee. It came from the, you know, Chinese San as well. So three.
Oh, yeah.
three means, you know, to me, three is all about community. It's about collaboration. It's about, you know, a group of people coming together. And
wait,
so.
Wait. Sorry to just, interrupt you, but why three is community for you?
Because it's like, if you have one person, it's solo. It's independent. Two is kind of like, is like kind of a meeting. But then gotcha. If you get three, that's the first, you know, three is the triangle is, I'm getting very deep now, but the triangle is like the first shape that you start to, it's the first shape, first of all, but then it's the first shape on your way to making a circle. And so if you keep adding more and more sides, then you get community.
That's cool, man. Yeah. You should put that on the cafe's origin. I don't know, like a brochure or something.
Yeah, totally.
It's a cool story. Yeah.
We have done that. So like, Sand Coffee Room now is no longer a cafe, in the true sense, but it's an agency. It's a creative agency for coffee projects. So we work with different coffee businesses and other creative businesses to do projects together, that just brings different industries together, whether it's, you know, creating video content, photo content, or, you know, events in person, or even helping to start cafes, like consulting and these kind of things. So, that's what Sand Coffee Room is. Go check it out, sandcoffeeroom.com or Sand Coffee Room on Instagram. Yeah. And then, yeah, my Instagram is the Nomad Brody, as I mentioned earlier. So that's, The Nomad and then Brodie. But I'm the only Brody Vissers out there, so I'm sure you'll find me if you type my name in. So yeah, like go check it out. And I want to tell your community, like, I want to hear from you. You know, want to, please feel free to write me, send me a DM, send me an email. I read all of them and I want to hear, you know, if you have any sort of projects that you ever want to work on, or if you just want to share your experience with coffee, or if you ever have any questions about, you know, about coffee that you never learned before. I love talking with people and I love, you know, hearing this kind of, inspiration. So yeah, please feel free to reach out. And, beyond that, I want to thank you, Takuya, for bringing me on here.
No, sweet. Yeah. All right, people, we got to follow this guy, man.
Yeah, right, I hope to see you guys soon.
Yeah, so just like, you know, just visit Japan sometime soon. Just hit me up, man.
I will. Yeah. I hope I can come back very soon.
All right, cheers, man. Yeah, thank you so much for joining us.
Arigato gozaimashita.
Do itashimashite. Arigato, yeah, Brody V.
Matane. Okay, ciao.
All right. OK。この最後の部分でですね。まあ、またノーマットの話に戻るんですけど、まあ、ノーマットになりたい、ノーマットライフスタイルをね、どっかで体験したいという人に何かアドバイスありますかというふうに聞いてみたんですけど、そこでは、そうですね。とりあえず、まあ、ちょっとでもこのノーマットライフスタイルとかに興味がある。そういった場合は、その自分の心地よさ、心地いいっていうののレベルとか、そういったのを下げていく。まあ、あとはそうですね。このプライオリティを下げる。このプライオリティのバー、そういったものを下げていく。それがいいというふうに言ってました。まあ、これはどういったことかというと、まあ、このノーマットライフスタイルの、とは、まあ、そのノーマットライフスタイルの魅力にもつながってくるんですけど、本当に自分の起きていること、自分に起きてくること、それに本当に自然に対応していく。そういったことが、まあ、魅力でもあるし、ノーマットライフスタイルの、必要なことというふうに言ってました。なので、ああ、自分はこれしないといけない、これしないといけない、これしないといけないとか、まあ、寝るのはここじゃないと、こういった環境じゃないと寝れないとかではなくて、まあ、ノーマットライフスタイルになると、まあ、日によっては、先ほどもね、ブローディが言ってたように、この空港で寝ないといけない時だったりとか、まあ、あとは、日によっては、全然面白い人にも全く出会えない、ちょっとね、この一人ぼっちな、ちょっとロンリーな日もあるかもしれない。まあ、でもそういった時にも、そういった一つ一つに適応していくこと、自分はこうじゃないといけないとか、そういったこと、そういった姿勢ですかね、それをなくすことが、まあ、アドバイスとして言えるかなというふうに言ってましたね。そしてまあ、最後にね、このブローディから、まあみんなに、僕もこのポッドキャストを聞いてくださってる皆さんと僕もね、繋がりたいと思ってますし、まあゲストとね、まあその皆さんも繋がっていければというふうに思ってこのポッドキャストをしてるんですけど、まあ一つのね、コミュニティとして考えてます。そういった中でね、まあこのゲストのことをもっと知りたいとか皆さんが思ってくると僕も嬉しいんですけど、ブローディ、 ぜひ皆さん、このね、オンラインでも、様々なインスタグラムとか、まあ、あとは、他の SNS もやってるので、ショーノートの方からチェックしてね、フォローなどしてみてください。本当に写真とかもね、めっちゃ綺麗、かっこいいので、フォローしてみてください。そしてこのウェブサイトですね、彼が行っている、この、コーヒーコンサルタントのビジネスなんですけど、もともとはこのトロントの、まあ、ビジネスパートナーと一緒にカフェを始めるということで始めた、この3コーヒールームですね。そう、123の3ですね。Number 3。この中国語でも3が3っていう風に言うらしいんですけど、まあ、なぜこの3なのかというと、この3っていうのが初めて形、まあ、コミュニティっていうことを表す言葉という風に言ってましたね。まあ、それはどういったことかというと、一人だったらもちろん一人ぼっちですよね。で、二人だったらま、ミーティングとか、でも3になって初めてそのコミュニティっていう風になってきますよね、3人。そしてま、3っていうのが、1だったらただのドット、点ですけど、2だったらま、線になりますよね、その点と点を結んで。まあ、3だったら初めてこのトライアングルとなって形になっていくので、まあ、そういった意味でこのコミュニティ、初めてのコミュニティが3である。ということから、この3コーヒールームっていうネーミングだそうです。すごくいいネーミングですよね。こちらのウェブサイトの方も載せておきますので、ぜひチェックしてみてください。で、まあ、ブロディが言ってたのは、まあ、皆さんからもね、いろんなメッセージとかを聞きたい。まあ、このポッドキャスト聞いてどう思ったとか、まあ、あとは、全く関係なくて、まあ、写真とか見てね、こうだとか、コーヒー、これがおすすめだよ。